we were talking about band instruments and just kind of grabbing.
I call this meeting of the Williamsburg James City County School Board to order. Item, 2.02, certified closed session. Can I have a motion, please?
I certify that to the best of each member's knowledge, the Williamsburg James City County School Board, while in closed session, discuss only public business matters lawfully exempted from open meeting requirements as stated in Virginia law, and that only such public matters as were identified in the motion convening the closed meeting were heard, discussed, or considered.
May I have a second, please?
Second.
Any discussion? It's been moved and seconded to certify closed session. Ms. Serza, will you call the roll, please?
Mrs. Taylor?
Aye.
Mrs. Young?
Aye.
Dr. Beers?
Aye.
Ms. Hummel?
Aye.
Mr. Kelly?
Aye.
Ms. Ownby?
Aye.
Ms. Cook?
Aye. Motion carries. That brings us to item 3.01, Pledge of Allegiance. I'd like to invite Aaron Thompson up to the microphone to lead us in the pledge. Aaron is an eighth grader at Towano Middle School. He is a member of the National Junior Honor Society, a trumpet player, and a black belt in Taekwondo. Welcome, Aaron. Anytime you're ready.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, Aaron. Item 3.02, the roll. Ms. Serza, will you call the roll, please?
Dr. Beers.
Here.
Ms. Hummel.
Here.
Mr. Kelly.
Here.
Ms. Ownby.
Here.
Mrs. Taylor.
Here.
Mrs. Young.
Here.
Ms. Cook.
Here. That brings us to item 3.03, approval of the agenda. Can I have a motion, please?
Madam Chair, I move approval of the agenda as presented.
Second?
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Any discussion? Ms. Serza, will you call the roll for approval of the agenda, please?
Ms. Ownby.
Aye.
Mrs. Taylor. Mrs. Young.
Aye.
Dr. Beers.
Aye.
Ms. Hummel.
Aye.
Mr. Kelly.
Aye.
Ms. Cook.
Aye. That brings us to announcements and superintendent's report. Dr. Heron.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Middle and high school parent information and curriculum fairs are being held throughout the month of February. These sessions give parents and students opportunities to learn about program offerings at individual schools, as well as the chance to visit a school and meet teachers and staff. For more information, visit wjccschools.org or call your child's middle or high school. School counselors help set goals, listen to individual student needs, and help foster positive relationships between teachers, students, and parents. During National School Counseling Week, WJCC students and staff showed appreciation for their school counselors through posters, tokens of appreciation, and food. These activities help show our counselors how important they are to our schools. Thank you, counselors, for all your excellent work. Random Acts of Kindness Week was held recently, and students across the school division focused on good and unity through acts of kindness toward one another. By performing simple acts of kindness, we have a positive impact on those around us, making the world a better place. On February 16th, elementary schools around the division celebrated the 100th day of school. Many students and staff dressed up as if they were 100 years old. This date marks a celebration of all the learning that has taken place already this school year, as well as the significance of the number 100 in the math curriculum. Those are all of the announcements I have this evening, Madam Chair.
Thank you, Dr. Heron. Ms. Ownby, do you have something to share?
Yes, just wanted to give a quick update. I attended the SEAC regular meeting on February 9th as the SEAC liaison. Wanted to share with folks that Dr. Barreau gave an update on the special education annual plan, explained to folks in attendance how federal funding for special education is determined. Ms. Bourgeois also gave a review of our board retreat as it related to the development of our budget, our budget retreat. There was a conversation among folks on the SEAC committee, as well as community members who were in attendance, about ways that SEAC and the broader community can support our budget process and advocate for funding and programs for our students across the division, in particular students with disabilities, but recognizing funding is needed across the board. Just a special note, One Child Center for Autism is hosting their regular monthly respite on February 25th, so information can be gotten online for families who would benefit from that program, for children who have special needs as well as are typically developing siblings. And then a special note, Dr. Barreau shared with us that we had 8 students this past year, students with developmental disabilities and IEPs, individualized education plans, participated in the Woodrow Wilson Rehabilitation Program in Fisherville to do some transition planning and job assessment, and that is an option that's available to families. Maybe not all families are familiar with that, so I'd encourage you to talk to your child's IEP team to see if that's something that your student would benefit from as students are exiting the system and looking for supports and programming beyond graduation. And then the next SEAC meeting, one last thing, is on March 9th. Again, that's open to the broader community at 6:30 at the Rec Center.
Thank you, Ms. Ombe. Are there any other announcements? Okay. That brings us to board recognitions.
Madam Chair, we have a few recognitions this evening. Let's begin by congratulating Lafayette teacher Richard Adal and his students for receiving the Virginia Star Best Practice Award. Through the school's technology courses, students refurbish and distribute computers and printers to members of our community. I'd like to ask Mr. Adal and students representing Lafayette High School to join us up front to be recognized. Madam Chair, tonight we'd like to take a moment to express our gratitude for the contributions this school board makes on our behalf. February has been designated by the Virginia School Boards Association as School Board Appreciation Month. Our board members play a critical role in the success of our schools and are dedicated to making sure our students receive a quality education. In recognition of your commitment and advocacy, board members, please come forward as your name is called and remain for a group photo at the end. First of all, Kira Cook, Chair of the Board. Holly Taylor, Vice Chair. Julie Hummel, Parliamentarian. Dr. James Beers, Member. Mr. Jim Kelly, Member of the Board. Lisa Ownby, Member of the Board. And Sandra Young, Member of the Board. Thank you very much. We encourage everyone to make a special effort this month to thank and acknowledge board members for their dedication to WJCC. Tonight we would also like to recognize another very special person, and that's the school board clerk, Janet Serza. The third week of February has been designated VSBA School Board Clerk Appreciation Week, and this week is designed to build awareness of the role board clerks may play in assisting members. Ms. Serza, can you please join us up front to be recognized? Thank you. That's a good thing. Thank you again, Ms. Serza. We appreciate all that you do. Madam Chair, this concludes recognitions this evening, and we will have more at the regular meeting in March. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Heron. That brings us to School Spotlight.
Thank you, Madam Chair. This evening we are delighted to have representation from Tuano Middle School to present a school spotlight this evening, and Ms. Jones, the principal of Tuano, will introduce her special occasion.
Thank you, Dr. Heron. It is my pleasure to be here with you tonight, to be with some of my wonderful students and teachers, to tell you about a project that we did this school year that enlightened us all and brought us together as a community. And one of the things we thought about this school year and back in November and October was the reflection story. What is my story was the theme for this last best school year. And we thought about what is our story as Tuano? How do we all intertwine to make it something that people want to know about and hear about? And also keeping the idea of individualism, which was one of the things that Dr. Heron kicked the school year off with, and reiterating with the teachers at convocation and opening up the schools with that. So one of the things we did was to bring our school together with the Passera Project. I have two wonderful teachers that will tell you more about that and how the collaboration, hopefully they're coming forward behind me right now, Mrs. Reed and Mrs. Harmon Link are with me, Reed and Harmon Link are with me to introduce you and tell you more about what that collaboration looked like in our school.
Okay. Good evening. My name is Anid Reed. I am a Spanish teacher at Tuano Middle School. I am here tonight with Tuano's administrator, Ms. Tracy Jones, the world language teacher, department curriculum leader at Tuano Middle School, Mrs. Harmon Link, and four of the students who are enrolled in the Spanish program at Tuano Middle School. We are delighted to present to you our school-wide community project called La Pulsera Project, and to talk to you about our purpose in joining the efforts of the nonprofit organization called the Pulsera Project. Pulsera is a Spanish term for bracelet, in this case, a hand-woven bracelet, like this one, made out of a variety of materials such as leather, wool, string, and beads. The pulseras are made by young artists who live in Nicaragua and Guatemala. Many, if not all of the artists, are youth at risk who live in the said impoverished countries. The school pulsera sales, such as the ones we have sponsored at Tuano Middle School, since this is our second year, help raise money to fund both education and work programs to keep youth off the streets and on their path to a brighter and more prosperous future. In our efforts to create a school-wide project, we were inspired by this year's district's reflection theme, This Is My Story, or Esta Es Mi Historia, to ask anyone to represent their life story in written or visual form is a daunting task, and one that can never be truly be completed as each one of us is living and creating our life story day by day, moment by moment. And yet, as we got involved in the process of representing our story, we discovered that although we are each unique and distinct, we all can come together to fulfill our goals as students, as a school, and as members of our global community that we know as WJCC Public School District. As world language teachers, we set out to instill a sense of uniqueness and unity. The Pulsera Project was our venue to teach about school, work, and life experiences that students in Spanish-speaking countries experience and compare that to our own. This is one school-wide project that tapped into our content area, as well as our souls, which will be imprinted in our hearts for years to come. I believe you will be just as thrilled as we are when you see the work so carefully crafted by each student and put together by the talented Mr. Peters, Tuano Middle School's art teacher. The work represents our story, nuestra historia. I leave you now with Mrs. Harmon Link.
Good evening, buenas noches. My name is Avery Harmon Link, and on behalf of all of the teachers, staff, and students at Towanda Middle School, I would like to extend our gratitude to the board for having us here tonight. We are honored to share with you the hard work and dedication demonstrated by the staff and students at Towanda Middle School through this Community Connections Project. We are absolutely amazed with the level of collaboration that took place among all of the grade levels and disciplines, with the creativity of our students, and with the beautiful pulsera that everyone in our school took part in creating. We have a video to share with you tonight, created by our talented ITRT, Kristen Barr, that demonstrates the passion of our students who so very much enjoyed participating in the school-wide project. We are thrilled that this project was able to instill in our students the idea that helping others is more about solidarity than charity, and that the importance of their education extends far beyond their own lives and will have a positive impact on our community and in the global community at large. We hope you enjoy the video and enjoy hearing from our students here tonight that participated in the project. Thank you, and without further ado, we present to you Towanda Middle School's Pulsera Project.
Hi, I'm Marvin Picardo, and I thought the Pulsera Project was such a great way to show respect and kindness, and I thought it really helped a lot of people in Nicaragua.
Hi, I'm Shia. I'm in 8th grade. When I first saw the Pulsera Project video, I thought it was really cool that our school is participating in a project like this because we're helping other people from different countries.
My name is Susan Yolsted, and I teach Foundations of Algebra 2 here at Towanda Middle School. The Pulsera Project gave us a great reason to review our perfect squares and our square roots. Pulsera talks about how people are threaded together and things they have in common to make one culture another culture into one. And we took that a little step farther and talked about the students' roots.
Hi, I'm Carrie. I'm one of Ms. Yolsted's students. And during the Pulsera, we did these four things, and those equaled up to us.
And hi, I'm Megan. My favorite part about the Pulsera Project was the math equation about myself that I separated into friends and family.
Hi, my name is Melina and I'm in 6th grade.
Hi, I'm Ashley and I'm also in 6th grade.
What I thought about the Pulsera Project, it was a little sad because people couldn't afford food, water, or money. And what class activities we did math, we did Chinese equations, and art we drew ourselves.
I thought it united us as a school because we all had a project to work on together and we could all help each other out with that project.
I'm Jeremy Riggs and I'm a 6th grade science teacher here at Towanda. And when I thought of Pulsera and togetherness, I thought of a unit, what we were working on in our unit, which was our carbon footprint. Because, you know, as individuals, we all contribute to the composition of the atmosphere and how much carbon we put in. But as a whole, you know, we're all one planet and we're all united, and we have to come together to make a difference.
I'm in 6th grade, and my favorite part of the Pulsera Project was my music part, because I really like music and I think it brings out the inner me.
Hi, my name is Emma Christ. I'm an 8th grader at Towanda Middle School. I felt that doing the Pulsera Project brought us all together in ways we didn't understand. Even grades, social status, shape, color, sizes, we all fit together in our one unified bracelet.
Hi, my name is Ashley Boquist, and after participating in the Pulsera project both this year and last year, I can definitely tell how much the project has grown and improved, making much more of an impact on the students and staff alike. First of all, last year, the bracelets were primarily sold at lunch. This year, however, the students were engaged in the project as well as the fact that they were sold at lunch. Students received pieces of paper, and the teachers were required to tell students something to write or draw on the paper. Students would then personalize the drawing to be unique to them. Then, when all the drawings were completed, they were weaved together and hung up by the entrance to the school, showing unity between everybody. Also, in students' foreign language classes, the teachers talked more about the heritage and about the people that made the bracelets and where they came from. In the end, I believe that the Pulsera project has developed so much since last year, making much more of an elaborate and engaging experience for all.
Hello, my name is Aaron Thompson, and I am an 8th grade student at Towano Middle School. My favorite part of the Pulsera project was in my civics class. In civics class, we work on collecting service hours and helping the community. For example, a few months back, we helped build a playground in the community. It brought our class together by doing something that we all had in common, and that we all like to do, and discovering that we all have a lot in common. Also, doing something for the community helped us come together and discover that helping the community can be fun. For the Pulsera project, we reflected on the service that we had done for others and drew a picture representation of our service hours. This helped us come closer together as a class and helped us come closer together to help kids in other countries that are poor and or have been war-torn. It helped everyone in our school realize that there are people that need our help in third world countries who are not doing well, and by helping them, we can make a difference and help those children and families.
Hi, my name is McKinley Dowdy, and I'm an 8th grader at Towano Middle School. For the Pulsera project, in each class, we did something different inside the bracelet. My favorite class was theater. We made origami stars out of different printed paper, and it shows that, as an individual, we're all a star. Even knowing we're all different, we can come together in different ways to help our community and make the whole sky. I like this project because it showed that we're all unique and we can come together like we did with the bracelet as Towano Tigers to help many other people in unique ways.
Hi, my name is Ryan Allison and I am in the 7th grade at Towano Middle School. The Pulsera project brings the school together because when students bought the bracelets, everyone was wearing the beautiful bracelets in unity. Also, everyone contributed to the Pulsera project by making a unique paper with all sorts of drawings and quotes. Then, every single paper was hung up in front of the office to make a big collage that ends up making the shape of a big Pulsera bracelet. We have some postcards that explain the Pulsera project. Do you have any questions?
Can you come share the postcards with us? Thank you. School board members have any questions?
No, I just want to say it's it's so colorful and fun and interactive. So I think it's one of those examples of all the different departments within a school all working together and showing that I my favorite quote was the uniqueness and unity, and that, to me, is what it's all about, showing both uniqueness and how you can be a unified team of people at Towano and Williamsburg and the United States, so, and the world. It's all great. Thanks.
Yeah, sure. I think two things that really struck me is your school is really, it's a real community where you live and work and play, and I think the other thing that I really appreciate is, and I think it's really important in this day and age, to recognize and honor other cultures from around the world, which this project really did, and you did it together as a community. It's wonderful.
Chair?
Yeah.
I just wanted to recognize how articulate each of you are as ambassadors for this program. You did a bang-up job. This is something really cool.
Yeah, I would concur with that. I'd like to thank the Tuano Middle School community for coming out and sharing this with us today. I'd also like to request to buy a bracelet next year, I think. So if that can be made available, to that opportunity, I think several of us would appreciate that. But I really am taken following up on what Ms. Hummel said about the interdisciplinary work involving the arts and math and science and civics and world language and, you know, to build world culture awareness and make those community connections both here and worldwide. So thank you for all your hard work, and thank you for coming to share this, your story with us. We really do appreciate it. That brings us to citizens' comments. Ms. Hummel.
Okay, and we have one citizen comment card, and this person really doesn't need this instruction, but I'm just going to have to do it because I'm parliamentarian. So this is the time when citizens who have submitted speaker cards are invited to address the board. Speakers are asked to come to the podium when their names are called, state their name for the record, and direct their comments to the chair of the board. Each speaker is allocated 3 minutes, and time cannot be yielded to another speaker. Personnel matters are not discussed in open school board meetings, and we ask that you refrain from making reference to specific individuals. The board is interested in hearing all comments fully and requests that citizens refrain from verbal outbursts, applause, or any other type of demonstration. Although the board does not respond to comments at this time, please know that we are listening and appreciate your time. And thank you for adhering to these guidelines. Madam Chair, my directions are concluded.
Thank you, Ms. Hummel.
All right, Kim Hunley and Scott Bowser, please.
Welcome.
Good evening, Kim Hunley. We understand it's board appreciation, and so we hope that you know how much we appreciate you each month. My exec team and other members are here as well tonight. And it's always amazing. I kind of never know what I'm going to say until like 2 days before. And it just to have the young people come talk about uniqueness and individuality. My quote on these chocolate stars say, look, we look up at the same stars and see such different things. And it just seemed to just play into exactly what the young people were saying, how different we are, and yet we're so unique. And so you have some chocolate from the exec board. And I also, one of the young ladies that was here with the gray, Miss Dowdy, her mother made this bracelet, and I have not had a chance to officially welcome Dr. Heron, but it's green, and so you can think of Ireland, and it has a little Celtic. So you get a bracelet even before you get the ones they talked about. But so we just want you to know how much we appreciate how you keep us in the loop, and you value our opinion as the Education Association, and we want to continue that. So, and then I'll let Scott.
Scott Bowser, still Tuano Middle School. And I just want to say, as you said, we know we don't get the thanks. You don't hear, not just teachers, but our bus drivers, our cafeteria workers, so many. So we want to say thank you right now. Ms. Young, Ms. Ownsby, we want to go ahead and thank you for your commitment to education. Dr. Beers, Mr. Kelly, thank you for choosing to spend your Tuesdays, Wednesdays, Thursdays, Fridays, Saturdays, Sundays with WJCC. Ms. Hummel, Ms. Cook, Ms. Taylor, this is for you. It's going to be extra energy for when y'all start rezoning and doing those attendances.
I don't know that some of those need the extra energy.
It is we who appreciate you.
Sir.
Thank you so much.
I'll take Mrs. Cook's chocolate.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Thank you, Mr. Bowser. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
meet all of the time.
Thanks. Thank you.
Oh, that'll be probably the end.
Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you both. That brings us to the consent agenda, which is going to take me a little while to read, so just hang in there with me. Item 7.01, approval of minutes from the following meetings, January 14, 2017, January 17, 2017, January 23, 2017, January 26, 2017, February 2nd, 2017, and finally February 7th, 2017. Item 7.02, the financial report and monthly bills and payroll for January 2017. Item 7.03, personnel actions as presented. 7.04, the very important school board clerk appreciation week resolution. 7.05, resolution R-7-17 for school social work week, also very important. 7.06, resolution R-8-17, national foreign language week. We got a little taste of that today. It was great. 7.07, high school band uniforms. 7.08, revise and rename policy JEC from admission of resident students to school admission. Item 7.09, revise policy JC, school attendance areas. Item 7.10, revise and rename policy JED from student absences and excuses to student absences slash excuses slash dismissals. Item 7.11, retire policy JECB, admission of non-resident students. Item 7.12, retire policy JECD, assignment of students to classes. And finally, 7.13, retire policy JEF, released time for students.
Madam Chair, I move approval of the consent agenda. 7.01, approval of minutes. No, as presented.
Can I have a second, please? Second. It's been moved and seconded. Any discussion?
Yes, second. I'll second it.
Ms. Sirza, it's been moved and seconded to approve the consent agenda. Would you please call the roll?
Ms. Ownby?
Aye.
Mrs. Taylor?
Aye.
Mrs. Young?
Aye.
Dr. Beers?
Aye.
Ms. Hummel?
Aye.
Mr. Kelly?
Aye.
Ms. Cook?
Aye. That brings us to action items. 8.01, renaming of Rawlsbird Elementary School to Laurel Lane Elementary School. Just a quick review, earlier in 2016, this board directed staff to begin the process of renaming Rawlsbird Elementary School. Later in the year, the board approved recommendation from staff to appoint an ad hoc committee who worked under Ms. Overkamp-Smith's leadership to work on that topic, and then that committee worked diligently and came to us with three recommendations. Those recommendations were discussed at our work session earlier this month, and board came to consensus with the motion that is before us. So if I could have that motion, please, I'd appreciate it.
Yeah, I move that the renaming of Rawlsbird Elementary School to Laurel Lane Elementary School effective July 1st, 2017, and affirming the Penguin as a school mascot.
Thank you, Mrs. Young. May I have a second?
Okay.
Seconded. Is there any discussion?
As long as we affirm the Penguin, we're great.
Yes.
Okay. If there's no further discussion, it's been moved and seconded to rename Rawlsbird Elementary School to Laurel Lane Elementary School, effective July 1, 2007, and affirming the Penguin as the school mascot. Ms. Thurza, will you please call the roll?
Ms. Hummel?
Aye.
Mr. Kelly?
Aye.
Ms. Ownby?
Aye.
Mrs. Taylor?
Aye.
Mrs. Young?
Aye.
Dr. Beers?
Aye.
Ms. Cook?
Aye. So this appears to be an early version of what we might anticipate in the coming months.
I like the laurels.
All right. All right. That brings us to item 8.02, appointments to Special Education Advisory Committee. Can I have a motion, please?
Madam Chair, I move that we appoint the three names that were moved forward as members of the SEAC committee.
Through October 31st, 2018?
Yes.
Excellent. We have a motion. Can I have a second, please?
Second.
Great. Is there any discussion? All right. It's been moved and seconded to appoint Diana Anderson, Beth Haw, and Kara Newman to the Special Education Advisory Committee through October 31st, 2018. Ms. Serza, will you please call the roll?
Mrs. Taylor.
Aye.
Mrs. Young.
Aye.
Dr. Beers.
Aye.
Ms. Hummel.
Aye.
Mr. Kelly.
Aye.
Ms. Ownby.
Aye.
Ms. Cook.
Aye. Motion has passed, and thank you and congratulations to the citizens who have agreed to serve in that capacity. That brings us to 9.01, Superintendent's Proposed Fiscal Year 2018 Budget. Mr. Kelly, you have something to say?
Oh, I do. As a member of the School Board of Williamsburg, James City County, I acknowledged I have an interest in the fiscal year 2017-18 school budget because my wife is an employee of the WJCC schools. However, I believe that I am able to participate in the consideration of and vote on the budget fairly and in the public interest.
Mr. Kelly, and I would like to take this opportunity to state that as a member of the School Board of the Williamsburg, James City County, I acknowledge that I, too, have an interest in the fiscal year 2017-18 school budget because I am an employee of the Williamsburg Health Foundation. However, I believe that I am able to participate in the consideration of and vote on the budget fairly and in the public interest. With that, before I hand it over to you, Dr. Heron, I would just like to remind the public that tonight we're going to hear your proposed budget for the first time. Our first meeting in March will be a work session that during which we will have an opportunity to discuss that proposed budget as a school board and begin the process of toward ultimate adoption. We will then have a regular meeting in March, at which point we may or may not choose to adopt that. I believe that's the 21st of March. And then we've reserved the 28th of March should we need that meeting to finally adopt a budget to request from the localities for funding. So with that, Dr. Heron.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Thank you for the opportunity to present the superintendent's proposed budget this evening. This is an extremely challenging budget year, and I know from the outset there will have to be some difficult decisions made as to what to include in the final WJCC budget. We are the 10th wealthiest state in the nation, yet the Commonwealth of Virginia is 35th in educational spending. This evening, Ms. Berta will provide information about decreasing levels of state funding over the last 8 years that have impacted public education. We'll see this evening that 62% of the superintendent's proposed budget consists of items either mandated by the state, such as the increase in VRS or staffing requests to meet the standards of quality, or they are things that are essential to the operation of the school division. Other requests we will present are real instruction and operational needs that will ensure our forward momentum and implementation of the current strategic plan. Ms. Bird is going to begin by giving us an overview this evening.
Good evening, Madam Chair, members of the board, Dr. Heron. Just a reminder, I feel like a broken wheel every time we talk about this, but it is important that the state code directs us under 22.1-92 that the superintendent and the school board shall adopt a budget that meets the needs that are required for the school division. Secondly, State Code 15.2-2503 reminds us that by April 1st of each year, we must pass an approved budget onto our funding partners for their review. Enrollment projections are one of the main components of developing a budget. Looking ahead using the Future Think Low enrollment projection, we are anticipating a growth of 28 students to an enrollment level of 11,459 students. For the past several years, FutureThink projections have provided enrollment estimates within 1% of the projected values. Looking at the FutureThink projections, we are forecasting continued growth in WJCC schools. Again, looking at FutureThink's low enrollment projections, we see continued growth. The green represents the actual enrollment as of September 30th, 2016, while the blue represents the estimated enrollment in 5 years, the school year 2021-22. Over the next 5 years, we project a growth of 232 students, 26 students at the elementary level, 28 students at middle, and 178 students at high school. In our review of per pupil expenditures, there are a few items to note. This graphic represents the per pupil cost as calculated for the state superintendent's annual report and includes the following. First, the calculations are based off the average daily membership, ADM, not actual enrollment data at one point in time. These calculations include pre-K, adult ed, food services, and capital budgets for replacements. They do not include capital outlay additions, meaning new construction or additions. The philosophy at the state level changed in 2012 to begin incorporating preschool. So prior to that, preschool was not included in those calculations. WJCC's per pupil expenditure is represented on the green bar, while the state average per pupil cost is represented on the line graph. Fluctuations in the per pupil cost occur due to the variance in capital funding, state mandates that don't include funding to support them, the addition of new programs without additional funding, and the opening of a new school or an addition. Couple of important things to note. In 2008 is when War Hill and Matoka opened in this division. In 2011, J.B. Blayton and Hornsby opened in this division. And some of the fluctuation between 2013 to 2015 directly relates to the change that was made by the Virginia Retirement System, requiring employees to contribute 5% to their retirement, while the localities had to fund 5% in a salary increase to offset that.
So that includes capital costs?
Capital replacement costs, not additions. Yes.
Capital replacement costs.
Like an HVAC or a roof.
So, but when you said we opened Matoka and War Hill in 8 and 9.
2008 is when War Hill and Matoka's operational expenditures would be included in that. So that would substantiate the climb from 2007 to 8 because you would have had to staff two new buildings.
Okay, so what's the decline in 12 to 13?
I think most of that is attributed to the fact, number one, that our capital replacement budget declined in that year, but also the change in VRS.
Okay, thank you.
The superintendent's proposed budget is based on the governor's recommended budget that was shared back in December. Sales tax forecasts do show a decline of $27,064 or 0.2% reduction. Standard of quality and categorical incentive are both showing increases for a total of $941,530 extra state dollars for this division or 3%. The net of those two together is $914,466 or 2.1% additional funds. It's important to note that the governor's proposed budget did incorporate a 1.5% bonus. We have removed that from this presentation because neither the House or the Senate have discussed that option. However, the House and the Senate version of the budgets do include some sort of additional funding for the school divisions, but unfortunately at this point in time we do not know what that impact will be on this division because they are still in session until the 25th. So keep that in mind as we're going through. We've removed the 1.5% bonus because we know it's off the table. However, there is something else coming, but we just don't know what that impact is. In the superintendent's proposed budget, this slide will show you the breakout of revenues expected for WJCC in this budget. Based on the superintendent's proposed budget, 25% of our funding comes from state SOQ and incentive, 10% from state sales tax, 0.64% from other funds, that is funds we are able to generate in-house by building rentals, sale of equipment, or interest on our funds. And then the majority of our funding comes from our localities. We are truly grateful for the support that we have received from Williamsburg and James City County in an effort to provide quality education for our students. As we shared with you and the public during the school board's retreat last month, The growth of this division has been 1,182 students, while the state funding has declined from 2009 levels by almost $1.1 million. Based on the governor's proposed budget for fiscal year 18, we would remain under the 2009 funding levels by $152,000, excluding any inflation adjustments, with a growth of 1,201 students in the same time period.
Since the budget retreat, where we presented a lot of priorities to the board for their consideration, we've already removed all of the following items from the proposed budget this evening. The additional pre-K site to provide classroom space at Rawls Bird and J.B. Bladen is not included, having reviewed the data by grade level in school and the projected low enrollment, we are delaying this for one more year. We are not including the additional funds requested for textbooks. We've developed a plan to purchase the needed books over the next 3 years, and currently there is still $160,000 allocated in the budget for textbooks. There was no consensus among board members for a comprehensive data analytics tool, so that, again, is not included in this particular budget. Due to the low projected enrollment again, we are postponing the addition of a trailer at Jamestown High School for one more year. Jamestown is currently over capacity by 139 students, but with 28 across the system, we believe that they will be okay for one more year. We are not including snow removal costs, and the impact of not including snow removal in the budget may result in being closed more days due to inclement weather. Currently, we have very limited internal capacity to remove snow. We are not including the requested additional staff for the Gifted and Talented program at this time. Currently, three part-time teachers serve three schools each for K through two students. We have also removed the request to add half an hour to the length of the day for instructional assistance at the elementary level. We plan to monitor this need for one more year. We are asking one special education aid less than the original request also. The original request for staff to cope with additional enrollment above the low projected enrollment or the Pathways Project or to serve additional special education students has been reduced from the original 8 in the request during the budget retreat to 2 in the superintendent's budget. To offset operating expenditures, almost $900,000 in decreases has already been incorporated into this budget, and that includes a number of things such as attrition savings, snow removal, energy savings, and other items as well. That's already built into this one. At this point, we're going to discuss additional staff member requests that are included in more detail. These requests are based on the standards of quality, a minimum standard for the delivery of education in the Commonwealth of Virginia. To meet standard of quality requirements, we're required to add several special education staff next year and a minimum of one English as a second language teacher. Ms. Bourgeois will provide information to help us fully understand the mandatory staffing requests in special education. And then following that, Ms. DePaula will address staffing to meet SOQ requirements for serving English language learners. Ms. Bourgeois.
Good evening. As we begin to discuss the growing enrollment needs, it is helpful to see where our students with disabilities break out across categories for K-12. Almost 60% of our students are identified with a specific learning disability or other health impairment. In addition, our percentage of students with autism represents over 13% of the population, and has increased consistently the past 3 years, with annual growth ranging from 10.2% to 11.35%. The number of students with a disability served in WJCC is just one consideration in determining staffing needs. The students come to us with a wide range of disabilities and accordingly a wide range of needs and services. For example, a student with autism may need a minimum amount of support during the school day, while another student, also with autism, may require a significant number of supports and services throughout the day. The level of services and supports for each student is determined by the student's individualized education plan, or IEP. A student needing services less than 50% of the school day counts as 1 point. A student needing services more than 50% of the school day counts as 2 to 2.5 points. Our SOQ requirements assign a maximum number of points per caseload for each teacher. For self-contained teachers for students with autism or multiple disabilities, the maximum caseload is 16 points. For all other WJCC special education teachers, the cap is 20 points. And currently, we have 10 teacher caseloads that are at cap within the division. As part of our child find requirement, the referral and eligibility process for special education services goes on throughout the year. Last year, WJCC schools completed 179 initial eligibilities, with 142 students found newly eligible for services. So far this year, there have been 55 initial eligibilities, with 43 students newly eligible for special education services. Typically, the busiest months are for eligibility are our spring months because they've been going through the tiers of intervention and child study, and typically now is when we will see an increase in the number of referrals for evaluation. The number of students eligible and the range of services needed are the components which drive the number of special education positions needed each year. This chart shows the December 1 student count for the past 4 years. This count is also the basis for our federal funding each year. Over the past 2 years, we have seen a marked increase in the number of students receiving special education services. In addition, since the December 1 count that you see there of 1,715 students, we have added an additional 15 students. This chart also shows the number of teacher and special education aid positions that have been added over the past few years to support the increase in students. Following the trend you see here in the chart, the fiscal year 18 budget includes 4 teacher and 2 aid positions. Based on our current numbers, this is the minimum request to support staffing needs. Thank you.
Good evening. WJCC English language learners represent 32 different languages. The majority, 77%, are Spanish speakers. 4% speak Mandarin Chinese, 4% speak Arabic, followed by Russian, Vietnamese, and Korean. We are quite a culturally diverse community of learners. Over the past several years, we are seeing increasing numbers of students with a significant interruption in formal education, particularly at the secondary level. This poses unique challenges for both our students and teachers, as there is a need to improve their language skills as well as catch up on grade level content. Virginia standards of quality require a ratio of 1 teacher for every 59 English language learners. We currently have 11 ESL teachers. Our enrollment necessitates at least 1 additional ESL teacher to serve our current population of ELLs. 40% of all English language levels in WJCC are level 2 or below. This means that they can convey simply detailed information using a combination of simple sentences and simple vocabulary. More instructional resources are needed for students at lower proficiency levels, and the SOQs do not take into account the language level needs that drive the amount of students for each of our students. Since 2009-10, we have experienced an increase of 454 students, and as you can see, each year our numbers are growing. To further illustrate our growth, we can look at the High School Newcomers Program, which opened 2 years ago with 20 students and is currently serving 80 students with intensive support in academic language and math. We are asking for 1 additional ESL teacher to continue support for our English language learners and serve them at the minimum standard.
In addition to required staffing, there are a number of other items that have been either mandated by state code or are essential for operating next year. Over 1.5 million of our request is for an increase in the required payment to the Virginia Retirement System. Increases in our contractual obligations add up to over 800,000, which includes health insurance, general liability insurance, workers' compensation, basic service contracts for operations and technology, and many others. We must hire a new principal for James Blair Middle School to get ready to open a new school next year. And there is a substantial increase in New Horizons program costs. Approximately $50,000 is for student enrollment in general programs, and approximately $200,000 of that amount is for specialized services for special education students. This figure is based on actual needs of students currently in the program.
What are the contractual obligations?
I've asked Ms. Berta to give us some of the specifics. There are a number of contracts that are renewed on an annual basis.
Never mind. We got it right here.
Thank you. When all of our total obligations are totaled, the proposed budget includes $3,152,101 in non-negotiable increases. And that includes the staffing you've heard about this evening. We have no control over these increases as they are driven by standards of quality and state-mandated changes such as the VRS. On the next slides, we are presenting other increases in the operating budget to meet our basic needs as a school division. Last year, we allocated funds to take compression out of the teacher scale. This requested salary increase will enable teachers to take one step on the teacher scale and give most other employees a 1.5% salary increase. Those at the top of the scale will not receive a raise under this recommendation. Currently, we allocate funds to individual schools based on a per-student basis. $135 for an elementary student, $160 for a middle school student, and $230 for a high school student. This, the request for $12,854, keeps the per-student amount the same as it has been for several years, with no increase, and that accounts for the 28 projected student enrollment. At the budget retreat, we discussed at length the need for additional support at the three middle schools. Currently, we have a school improved. We discussed at length the need for additional support at the three middle schools. Currently, we have a school improvement specialist at each high school. This position is part of the leadership team, oversees testing, assists with data analysis, and the school improvement plan. This is a teacher leadership position, a training position for future assistant principals. This person will provide significant support for the overstretched administrative teams at all three middle schools. Last on the instructional needs are two instructional positions. They could be used for pathways or additional needs in special education or general enrollment above the low projection. During the budget process, we reviewed valid requests for over 30 additional staff throughout the division. This budget includes 13.85 positions. Seven of those are required by Virginia Code standards of quality. On page 11 of your budget book, we actually have a list of all of those positions. These are our instructional priorities for next year. Currently, we have deployed an effective personalised learning programme in grade 6 and 7 at all three middle schools and in grade 8 at Tuano Middle School. This request completes the implementation of personalised learning at the middle school level. The impact of not doing this would mean that current 7th graders in Berkeley and Hornsby would enter the 8th grade and not have the technology they need to continue the personalised learning programme. Each year, more students are taking virtual or blended learning courses. In 2015, we had 135 students enrolled in 15 courses. In 2016, we had 321 enrolled in 23 courses. And this year, so far, we have 465 students enrolled in 29 courses. This funding pays for teacher stipends for teaching blended learning courses and writing blended learning curriculum. This request maintains the current level of offerings. The impact of not funding this would result in fewer students having access to fewer courses. The other item on this slide is to fund the Pathways program. The WJCC innovative redesign of the high school experience for students is in the first year of its implementation at Warhill High School and in the planning stages at Jamestown and Lafayette High Schools. The implementation of Pathways necessitates additional funding for transportation, laptops, and specialized furniture and technology. The impact of not funding this could be a discontinuation of the program, and we would have to repay grant funding to the Virginia Department of Education. Finally, on this slide, we are expanding, or we hope to expand, the early college program with TNCC to Jamestown High School and Lafayette High School. This funding includes the payment of 6 college credit hours per student in the program, up to 50 at Warhill High School in year 2 of the program, and to launch the program at Jamestown High School and Lafayette High School. As you are aware, we have a bus replacement plan that ensures our buses are operational and safe. To continue the replacement plan, we are requesting 2 buses next year, or in this budget. With the opening of the new middle school, there is a need to redistrict at a minimum at the middle school level. Redistricting could also impact school capacity at other levels. And this is a placeholder, a potential cost for redistricting. Included also is $30,000 to reauthorize the strategic plan for the next 3 to 5 years. This process actually cost $69,000 last time. And finally, we currently do not translate major documents such as the Program of Studies, the Code of Conduct, and other division documents. This funding would enable us to translate major documents into Spanish, which a large number of our students and families speak. And I'm going to ask Ms. Berta to take us through some summary slides to finish the presentation this evening.
Thank you. As a recap, we are projecting an enrollment increase of 28 students, which equates to about 0.25%. We are requesting 13.85 additional positions, or 0.8% increase, and an operating budget of $132,657,854, or an increase of $5,088,050, or 4%. As a reminder that Dr. Heron discussed, 62% of our budget is non-negotiable items, and 38% we have the ability to make decisions over inclusion or exclusion from the budget. A snapshot of our operating expenditures by object. As you look at wages and benefits, it represents 86.38% of the superintendent's proposed budget. That is people and staff, meaning we don't have the ability to adjust much beyond that in support of the budget. Looking at our operating expenditures by function, our focus is right where it should be on instruction. We are in the education business. 82.86% of this operating budget is dedicated to instruction. In this superintendent's proposed budget, we are asking a local revenue appropriation increase of $4.2 million, or 5.1%. State sales tax is forecasted to decrease by $27,064, or 0.2%. State revenues, based on the governor's proposed budget, is projected to increase by 3%, or $941,530, and other revenue increase of $21,000, or 2.9%. Much of the discussion we have had today revolves around the operating budget. However, there are other components of our overall total budget. Those include our grant funds, which are federal and state funds that we receive to support our educational programs. We are projecting an increase of $162,943, or 3.1%. State-operated fund is Eastern State and Merrimack Center. We are projecting a $10,402 increase, or 1%.
and our child nutrition services projecting an increase of $16,092 or 0.4%. So the superintendent's overall proposed budget is $143,287,108 or an increase of $5,277,487 or 3.8%.
We are very aware that this current budget year, it will be very challenging for our funding partners to fund all of our budget of need. Therefore, this slide presents some options for us to consider to bridge the potential funding gap as part of the budget development process. Obviously, the school board may consider removing or delaying some of the prioritized needs identified in the budget already. The administration also is seeking direction on whether or not the school board would like us to provide information on ways to reduce health insurance costs. As you know, personnel costs, wages, and benefits represent over 86% of our total budget. We can provide information on cost sharing, adding a spousal surcharge like most other divisions, or any other options that the school board would need information on. Another option is increasing class size. That would result in a reduction of personnel through attrition and significant savings, but is not an ideal option. We can look at the option of reducing the allocation per student to schools. It has been the same for many years, but there is always the option to reduce that a little bit as well. Or any other options the school board would wish us to bring information to you so that we can look to bridge the gap. It's an extremely challenging budget year, and staff are ready to work on all options to bridge the gap between our identified needs and available funding from our funding partners. Ms. Berta will now conclude by just giving us a timetable of where we go from here. Thank you, Ms. Berta.
Thank you. Just a few reminders about the rest of the budget process. We are scheduled to have a public hearing on the superintendent's proposed budget at our next meeting, March the 7th. There is a joint city-county school budget meeting on Friday, March 17th. A school board discussion and/or approval on March 21st. If necessary, a school board discussion and approval on March the 28th. Following approval by the school board, we will deliver the budget to the city and county by April 1st. The county budget adoption is currently scheduled for April 25th. The city budget adoption is scheduled for May 11th. And then the school board adoption of an operating and capital improvement budget for fiscal year 18 is scheduled for May 16th. That concludes our presentation, and we will certainly entertain questions or comments this time.
Thank you all very much. So to reiterate that the next meeting, we have an opportunity to really hash through these things, but I think some of the direction that it would be helpful for staff to hear from all of you tonight would be what information that we don't already have, would you like staff to be prepared to share with us in advance of the March 7th work session? Specifically, I think at that session we can talk about what wasn't included in this budget that we'd like to put in, or what was included that we may want to take out or adjust in some way. But I think the other piece is which were on the slide, second to last slide, what other options do you want staff to bring to you? To think about. So with that, does anyone want to start? Dr. Beers?
Sure, I'll start. I think for our work session, I think it would be really important to bring forward what the consequences of some of these various options are. And I think the other thing, too, is I would like to know what the superintendent also considers in terms of if we have to reduce in some of the areas where you think it's the least painful it's going to be painful anyway. But I'd like to have a sense of how you might prioritize some of those things. I also Everybody wants to deal with that, is how to adjust health insurance benefits. What are, I know there are a couple of different ways of going with that, but let's look at that more closely, and especially in terms of the dollar figures on that, I think. Because we've started to do that. I think that's a good place to start with the work session is done that already, where some of those might be and
I was looking at the chart that you gave us here. You know what I'm talking about is 62% is non-negotiable, 38% is negotiable. Can you give us a list of the negotiable ones that we...
It's in the presentation. It would be everything that's not marked on the slide headers as non-negotiable.
Okay, and then in our books that we've received about the budget, are those designated by negotiable or non-negotiable?
They are not in your book.
Okay, because that would be helpful.
Michelle, we can certainly provide just a list of things if that's easier for the board's consideration.
Yeah, I think
of,
it would be
of
easier.
Of things that are real needs, but we realize that they're competing for
because
funds.
Because as we, Dr. Heron, as we look at the, oh, I'm sorry, Madam
I was
Chair.
Just going to say if you could provide that list and perhaps reference what pages they can be found
yes.
on in the budget, that would be
absolutely.
Ideal.
Absolutely, we can do
yes,
that.
Yes, I think that would be helpful. Thank you. I forgot my train of thought, so. That's okay.
Sorry, I interrupted
I'll think about
you.
It.
We'll come back. Zombie, did you have anything?
Just, I concur with Dr. Beers. I think if we could fully flesh out the health insurance, as many options as possible in ways that we could reduce cost. And then along those lines, considering if we did reduce instructional funding, like what would that look like? Could you give us different scenarios?
Yeah. We can certainly look at our standard ratio of student to teacher, and we can give you what it would look like if we were to add one per class and give you a sense of the numbers of the cost savings there.
Mr. Kelly?
Sure. One question as we're going through this, how do we serve all those different languages? I mean, I don't expect that you have one ELL teacher that knows 15 of those languages.
No, we don't have immersion programs. Our focus is on getting their English language skills up to par and progress through the different levels of language. So we do not deal with our students in Mandarin or in Arabic. We're fortunate to have several English language students, ESL teachers that speak Spanish, but we're focusing mostly on English instruction for our 32 different languages.
That was just an interesting graphic for me. Health insurance costs for this year. Our current projection is that they are not going up at all, right? 0% increase?
That is correct.
So we haven't changed if we keep them the same as they are now.
That's correct.
The pie chart you had in there for funding that showed state and local funding, in 2008, I'm sure that was a much different look. The local share of the funding was a lot less than what it is today. Would that be correct?
I'd have to actually pull that because local composite index back in 2008 was a completely different picture than what it is right now. So that may not be a factual statement. I can pull that for you, though.
I'd just be kind of curious okay. about that. I think Dr. Heron's point of Virginia being the 10th wealthiest state, but ranking 35th in education funding is a sad state. Sad discussion on what's going on in Richmond as it relates to our education funding. One concern I have is, and I've said something like this before in previous years, we are in the people business. Our product is people. Our students come out, what we use to produce those students is our teachers. I am very concerned about anything that takes money out of a teacher's pocket, whether that is deflecting our health insurance, our costs onto teachers. I'm just very concerned about the impacts of balancing our budget on the backs of our teachers.
We ask a lot of our teachers, and we have not rewarded them since 2008. We've had some paltry increases. Generally, they have been, their salaries have been held the same. And I think that not only for our teachers, but for really for the sake of the profession, we need to honor our teachers and show them that we really support them and care about them. And any changes in benefits, which puts cost onto not just the teacher but the teacher's family, I think we have to be very, very thoughtful about.
I just have a question for Ms. DiPaolo. Where do people that speak Gujarati, where do they come from?
India.
From India. Okay,
thank you. And Pakistan.
Just to follow up, I think another way to value our teachers is to ensure that we don't increase class size. And so I know we'll get to flesh this out more next week, so I was holding back, but I felt compelled to address that. So I think we will have to make difficult choices. And so for me, if we can ensure that our class sizes remain constant and not increase, that is a way to value our teachers as well.
On the operating expenditures by object chart, I think it would be helpful for me. This is our WJCC operating expenditures of wages versus benefits. So when we talk about benefits, is a 27.13%, how does that stack up against other like school districts? I just would be curious. Are we spending more than our...
That I don't know without looking into it. I do know that we have a consistent VRS rate, so that is a big piece of that. That's 16.32% of that. Of that piece of the pie, 14% is for employer health insurance cost.
Okay.
So we'd have to look and see how we stack up in health insurance costs, because I think that's probably going to be the variable when you look at other divisions.
So that would be helpful for me to just say, as we're making these difficult decisions, what are our neighbors doing? Our neighbors, have they made these tough decisions already?
Building on that, I guess I'd like that... I'd like to see another part pie chart made up of the 27.13 of what's negotiable and non-negotiable in that wedge, so that we know what we can discuss and what we can't. Thinking about the work that we need to do between now and our March 7th work session, there's several pieces of information I'd like to better understand. The first is what the gap is that we know today, you know, at that time, between what this request is and what we can anticipate from the state and the localities, you know, what they've budgeted for. I know James City County does it biennial budget, but the city doesn't. But even if we use last year's allocation or mirror the percentage increase in the city or something like that, so we can get an understanding of what kind of gap we may be looking at. If our largest local funder decides to stay where they are. I think taking back anything that's been promised to teachers or staff is a terrible idea, and scaling back on what they've been accustomed to, I think, doesn't reflect a respect for the work that they do. And even if we do determine that our compensation with benefits, for instance, is comparatively good. Finding ourselves in a nation where teacher shortages are everywhere, you know, it's just something that we're going to have to eventually grapple with. We haven't had to yet, but I think we just, as a division, we have to understand what not honoring our staff can do in terms of, you know, having them perhaps find work elsewhere, what that means long term. So that said, I would also like to see what the savings might be if we do increase class size. I'm not in favor of that, but I think we have to do our due diligence work and be able to put a number to it. I think we have to go into a conversation with our eyes wide open. Also, I would like to understand if it's possible, again, knowing that there are teacher shortages out there, so I'm not in favor of this, but I think, again, part of our due diligence work and keeping our eyes wide open, if there's an opportunity to, we've got longevity pay at the top of the, for some of our teachers that are the most dedicated to our learning community, have been here the longest, is there an opportunity to provide some sort of benefit to for them to exit earlier, an early retirement? I don't know if that's what you would call it. I'd like to understand what we can regain if we do create a surcharge for spouses, maybe a couple different opportunities for that, if we do have to charge for that benefit, and see what the division can save in there. I'd like to understand our health insurance benefits compared. I think other people talked about benchmarks. I don't like talking about our health insurance benefits as a percentage. What percentage do we pay? I think a dollar figure makes more sense. We invest this much, and then people can buy up, for instance, if they want to. And I think we instituted that last year. It was Mr. Baker, I think that's what you worked on last year. So kind of building an understanding on that. But is there an opportunity, if not for teachers who are currently in the system, is there a way to grandfather so that we can realize future savings and maybe drive people towards the consumer-driven model, which is the trend in healthcare these days, if there is a trend, because it's totally chaos, actually. And then Mrs. Hummel brought up something, I think at the last meeting, about our policy for allowing teachers who don't live in the district to bring their students here, and is there an opportunity? I mean, I know that we may be leaving money on the table there, but we also get a benefit for that because we do get money for the ADM, right? Is that right? ADM. So understanding what that net. So that's kind of my list of things I'd like to better understand, and so that we can talk about those topics next meeting. And then I think in the near term, because it's time sensitive, I'd like to get kind of an understanding from you all what you think about Dr. Heron's mentioning of the Pathways program. Right now, enrollment is, that process of signing up for classes next year is well underway. And it's going to be many weeks before we adopt a budget, and the Pathways program is an increase in cost, and so I wanted to get from you what your thoughts were about expanding into next year or delaying that based on some of the information that we were presented tonight. So does anyone have any thoughts on that topic that we can give direction to staff sooner rather than later?
I'd be interested in knowing if we have a process at Lafayette and Jamestown. How far along are they? How mature are they? Are they ready to go? Are they not ready to go? Concerned that they aren't ready to go and that we're going to rush into something.
Obviously, both the income and planning schools are not ready yet, but they are working through the process. It's February now, and they're supposed to be ready by the end of June to launch next year. So currently they're in the process of writing curriculum, planning what their program's going to look like, trying to, just at the same stage as Warhill was last year, but they haven't actually invited students to be part of it. We've advertised that the three programs will exist, but they haven't had individual parent evenings where they invite students and parents to come and really learn about the program. So as yet, we've no student commitment to the two new programs. We do have, obviously, to Warhill. One other impact would be if we were to not do the Warhill into the second year, we'd be in a position to give $100,000 back to the State Department, because they have got had $50,000 each year for planning and then for implementation this year. And we don't know if there's monies coming with the second year of implementation next year.
Yeah, I believe we've made a commitment to the students of Warhill, and so I'm really hesitant about that. But I'm wondering if expansion of the program to Lafayette and Jamestown at this time is affordable based upon the budget challenges that we see in front of us.
It certainly adds additional cost to the budget, and I think, to be fair, the real cost per student of the program at Warhill is still being determined, looking back at all the expenditures from last year. If we weren't to expand to Lafayette and Jamestown, we would probably save at a minimum of $200,000. We would have to give $25,000 per school back to the State Department because of the planning year. I think I heard Ms. Cook say delay, not stop, which I think would be significant, because a certain amount of excitement and energy has gone into the planning of the two incoming programs.
Would
we have to give back the $25,000 if we were just delaying it?
We would need to ask that question of the State Department. They may give another year of planning. We certainly can ask that.
Yeah, that was the question I was going to ask. Yeah.
Absolutely. I can ask.
Because it is. I mean, it's a sizable amount.
Right.
I know that we have there's a large budget item connected to the and our laptops too.
Right.
That's almost $500,000.
I was confused about that in the budget with the knowing that Warhill was going on first, and we had 300 laptops in the budget for Pathways, but we really only need 100.
100 for the incoming ninth graders at Warhill, 100 for Jamestown, and 100 for Lafayette High School first year.
But that's not related to Pathways?
That's all Pathways.
If Lafayette and Jamestown are in the planning phase.
But we're planning now for next year's budget.
Okay,
and so
okay.
The program is dependent upon the technology.
Gotcha.
It's a huge piece of it.
So okay. It's that additional laptops for Warhill.
Additional ones, because they've already got them. Does Warhill already have the first set?
Yes, their ninth graders have a laptop as part of their program. When they move to 10th grade, they would take the laptop with them. And so ninth grade.
That's where you've got that.
And so it's a two-year pilot program, so to fulfill what's been required from the beginning, we'd have to bring in the incoming ninth graders.
If we did delay or postpone the implementation of Pathways at Jamestown and Lafayette, would that program be, then I would guess that program would be open to those students from Jamestown and Lafayette, so they could apply to Warhill?
Absolutely.
Yeah, a question that I had raised earlier, and I'd like to see how that breaks down. I asked about how much, what's budget, how much would I budgeted for travel, and it's $250,000. And I'd like to know if you pare that down, looking at, you know, it's like, okay, I'm a school board member, I decide, okay, I'm not going to go to the conference, I'm not going to, some of those other things, if we eliminated some of those and really looked, the people in charge of their cost centers, especially the ones dealing with instruction, could we pare some of that down to, you know, see if we could?
Yeah, we can certainly bring some thoughts to you about what we could decrease the budget across the travel budget across the whole system, and what that would look like. And there may be some savings, and we would have to put restrictions on out of state travel for the year, and that would be for everyone.
Madam
Chair, just to go back for a moment to Pathways, I think it would behoove the division to do some program evaluations rather than continue to move forward with Lafayette and Jamestown, as excited as I know folks are. We really don't know. There's a lot we don't know about War Hill, and so I think to do an honest assessment of that program evaluation before we move forward is a smart thing to do.
If I could comment on that, the program evaluation of War Hill is in process, and it's been done by the College of William and Mary, and that will be presented to you in June. So we won't know about how well that program has gone and some of the feedback from it until the end of this year.
So they're probably still in the process of gathering data.
Yeah. They are gathering data as we speak.
Okay.
So with the hope of giving the division some guidance in the interim between now and March 7th, specific to Pathways, I am primarily because of what Ms. Ombi said, and knowing that a portion of the funding from the state did go to support evaluation by William and Mary, and I'm really excited to see that. I think moving forward, without having that evaluation data in hand and the analysis of that data, and also allowing those schools to benefit from lessons learned. So I'm in favor of delaying for budgetary reasons, but also for program integrity purposes. I don't know.
No, I agree with that. I think we need to know how successful or whatever the metrics are that they're going to evaluate. I think it would be wise to wait.
I agree.
Pathways.
Yeah, because there are a number of sources of costs for that going, you know. Everybody may not be pleased with it, but it's an area that you just have to consider. It falls into the instructional area.
Yes, I guess I would too. Although I caution all of us when we are creating new programs that in the creation of the new program have all of a sudden result in a equity issue with the other high schools that cannot take advantage of it. And when I add the Pathways at War Hills to the Project Lead the Way at War Hill, so you've got one high school that has two really phenomenal, I think, opportunities along with the relationship with Thomas Nelson Community College, so actually three different really nice options for high school students that are in the attendance zone for War Hill. I just think we have to keep that in mind when we look at Jamestown and Lafayette and the students that are zoned to those areas, what their opportunities are. And I just think it's something we need to always keep in mind. And I know we can't, everyone can't be equal and there can't all be equal. School doesn't have to look cookie cutter. However, I do think we need to always be looking at making sure that it shouldn't matter where you live, what kind of experience you have.
So for clarity, Ms. Cook, where the board is giving direction to delay the implementation of Pathways at Jamestown High School and Lafayette High School until further notice, knowing that staff will probably want to continue planning with the potential of implementing next year, I will phone the State Department and see if we can delay implementation or not. Give back funding. If we do, we would be giving $50,000 back to the state, but that is less than the program will cost. Also, with reference to what Mrs. Hummel was saying, the early college program, we want to, at this moment, keep it in the budget because it is bringing that to Jamestown High School and Lafayette High School next year, and that is an equity issue. So that program will, it's for the moment, it's in, will remain in the budget.
Okay.
Thank you.
And anything else on the? Thank you very much to all of you for your hard work on this. It was very enlightening, if not depressing. That brings us to item 10.01, board member comments and requests. Young, do you have anything?
Well, I just want to thank Christina and Dr. Heron for their hard work in preparing us for the budget. I know that's a, I bet you'll be glad when the budget season is over, but thank you very much.
Zombie?
Yes, hi. I wanted to thank Principal Karen Swan for the tour that she provided to both me and Ms. Cook. Was very impressed with her staff commitment to the whole needs of the students in that school. So just as a community, as we think about budgets and supporting our schools, I think it's important to note that in our community, we have a growing number of children who receive free and reduced lunch. That number is pushing towards 40%. We have a growing number of children who are homeless. That number is close to 400. And so was amazed with how Principal Swan and her staff are meeting the needs of the children in their school, which go way beyond academic. And again, I think along the lines of budget, as a school division, as we talk about systems, approaches, and meeting the needs of our students, we might need to look at how we can systematically meet the needs of all of our children, which go outside of the classroom, to ensure that they are ready to learn when they get to school. Also wanted to note, was impressed with Principal Swan's acknowledgement of African American History Month, and did want to note that schools across the division, in their own unique way, acknowledged this important month. And so she had a chance to share that with me and Ms. Cook when we were there. Wanted to thank Mr. Snipes for his tour of operations. I've never been to the Operations Center and was floored and impressed by all of the things that go on behind the scenes. I had no idea that we have staff carpenters and HVAC experts, in addition to our bus drivers and other folks who work behind the scenes to ensure that our schools are successful. So there's a lot of staff that we don't know are doing a phenomenal job. And so I appreciate that, Mr. Snipes. And wanted to thank, also give a shout out to our PTA and PTSAs and band and athletic boosters. And while all of us are focused on what happens in the classroom, there are so many things that are just as important that don't happen in the classroom. And so those organizations with parent and family volunteers, community volunteers, make a huge impact in the lives of our students, bring a sense of community. And again, there are folks behind the scenes who work for us, who help with additional setup and cleanup. I know just last week there was family and student breakfasts at Lafayette and DJ and band booster band, band dance. And so thanking folks for all that they do. That's it for my kudos.
Thank you, Ms. Homie. Dr. Beers?
I want to really commend Dr. Heron and that financial staff, because this was easily the most clearly presented budget I have seen and read in a long time. And I found it was also really helpful to share questions and talk about various elements of the budget. For tonight's meeting, just made it that much clearer to me. And I know we're going to have some difficult decisions. We always do, because there's a finite amount of money, taxpayers' dollars, as it were. We have a real fiscal responsibility to try to get as much out of each buck as we can. So I commend, I really do. I was really very much impressed.
Dr. Beers. Mr. Kelly?
Madam Chair, I'd just like to tell Mrs. Owenby that she hasn't really been to operations until you've been there on the first day of school. That is a completely different experience when you do that. I would like to also add my thanks to Mrs. Berta and Dr. Heron and all of the others who helped put together the budget. I know it's a team effort and a lot goes into it. I appreciate the good hard work there. I look forward to seeing what comes out of the General Assembly, and hopefully they do the right thing and start to begin to fund public education where they could. We do have tough decisions to be made with this budget. The tough decisions may be not touching our teachers' benefits.
Other divisions may have made the easy decisions by cutting teacher benefits, but programs do not work without teachers. New programs do not work without teachers. I feel that we must show a commitment to our teachers, and I would be very hard-pressed to support a budget which violates promises we've made to our teachers or which takes money out of our teachers' pockets or out of our teachers' families' pockets, particularly in a year where our insurance is not changing. We have, in the past, we have adjusted salaries and then adjusted insurance to the negative. We worry about our climate survey, and then we look right-sizing teacher benefits. What message are we really sending our teachers? I'm just really concerned about that and what our teachers come away from this discussion with.
Taylor? I just wanted to thank everyone for the budget presentation. I know we don't make your job very easy with lots of our tasks and questions, but you always come prepared and help us to make very informed decisions, and we appreciate that.
Thank you. I just wanted to comment that I've been in this community for nearly 30 years, which makes me feel very old. But I don't recall a time that we've been this close to SOQ on anything. And listening to the conversation, the well-considered, well-researched, thank you very much conversation about our English language learners and our special ed population, just I found to be, frankly, not where this community is used to being. And I lament that we are where we are because of the way the state has chosen to not fund, and so none of the decisions that we have before us this year are going to be fun or easy to make. But unfortunately, we may not have a choice, and we do have a choice in what we send to our funding localities, but what they are able to fund may put us in a position where we have to make hard choices. And so with that, I just want us to be as wide-eyed as we possibly can be, knowing that the problem lies in Richmond. As Mr. Kelly often says, the problem does not lie in Mounts Bay or Lafayette Street. So anyway, with that, I want to move on to any more? With that, I'd like to move up to upcoming events. The School Liaison Committee is February 22nd at 4 p.m. in room 309 at the Annex at the School Board and Central Office. And then Special Education Advisory Committee meeting is on March 9th at 6:30 in the James City County Community Center. Upcoming meetings, tonight there's a meeting right after this one of the James City County School Board, and as soon as I gavel out, Mrs. Taylor will gavel in. And then there's a closed session on March 7th at 6 p.m. At the Annex at James Blair, followed by a public hearing on the budget we just heard, also in room 300 at the Annex at James Blair, followed then by a work session where we will discuss thoroughly, I believe, the budget we just heard, also in James Blair. And then again, on March 17th at 9 a.m. at James Blair, we will have, in the Annex, we will have a joint meeting with the James City County Board of Supervisors and City Council, and we will be hosting that. And then lastly, we will have a meeting on March 21st at 6 p.m. here in Council Chambers, that closed session at 6, followed by a regular meeting at 6:30. And we may then, at that point, need to have a meeting on the 28th of March as well, but we won't know that until that time. So with that, this meeting is adjourned. I did that for you, Mr. Kelly.
I appreciate that.
I'm good. Let's go.
Need a break.
Let's go.
Come on, chair. Let's get this done.
Down.
when they're ready.
They're ready. Tack, tack.
Find the community that SOQs are not where we want to be.
I give them a minute.
Hey, Lisa. You ready?
You ready?
Yes, I'm ready.
Ready.
Sorry.
Great. I call the special meeting of the James City County School Board to order. Ms. Serza, can you call the roll, please?
Dr. Beers.
Here.
Mr. Kelly.
Here.
Mrs. Young.
Here.
Mrs. Taylor.
Here.
And Ms. Ownby.
Here.
Then we move on to 13.02, approval of the agenda. Can I have a motion to approve the agenda, please?
Madam Chair, I move approval of the agenda as presented.
Is there a second?
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Ms. Serza, can you call the roll, please?
Ms. Ownby.
Here.
Mrs. Young.
Here.
Dr. Beers.
Here.
Mr. Kelly.
Aye.
Mrs. Taylor.
Aye.
We're approving the agenda.
All right. That brings us to 13.03, citizens' comments. We have no citizen comment cards this evening. So that brings us to 13.04.
Madam Chair, I move that the James City County School Board annual salary be adjusted to $7,500 per year for regular members and $8,700 per year for the chair.
Is there a second?
Second.
Any discussion?
I think it should be noted that the school board salary has not been adjusted, or actually stipend, because it's not a salary, has not been adjusted since 2005. And the county has had significant increase in both population and student enrollment since that time. And I believe it's appropriate.
Any further discussion? Just as a reminder, a local school board representing a county may establish a salary increase prior to July 1 of any year in which members are elected or appointed, or if such school board is elected or appointed for staggered terms prior to July 1 of any year in which two of the five members are to be elected or appointed. Such increase shall become effective on January 1 of the following year. If there's no further discussion, I'll ask Ms. Serza to call the roll.
Mrs. Young.
Aye.
Dr. Beers.
Aye.
Mrs. Taylor.
Aye.
Mrs. Ownby.
Aye.
Mr. Kelly.
Aye.
All right. And with that, the motion passes and meeting is adjourned.